नमस्कार, हेलो माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स. टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द पार्ट थ्री ऑफ एग्जामिनेशन ऑफ कंप्लीटली एडेंटुलस पेशेंट. वी विल डिस्कस द रिमेनिंग पार्ट ऑफ द इंट्रा ओरल एग्जामिनेशन. वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड द फिजिकल एग्जामिनेशन इन द पार्ट वन ऑफ द वीडियो. पार्ट ऑफ द इंट्रा ओरल एग्जामिनेशन इन द पार्ट टू. रेस्ट ऑल वी विल डिस्कस इन दिस वीडियो along with the treatment planning and the prognosis, existing dentures, and the importance of radiographs. In the intraoral examination, we were left with the lateral throat form, retromyelohyoid space or the postmyelohyoid space, mucosa thickness and the condition, frenal attachment, tongue, saliva, prognosis, the importance of existing dentures, and the importance of radiographs. Dear students, these all points are very important. You will have to mention all these points during the history taking and examination in the practical exam. Lateral throat form, also called as retromyelohyoid space or the postmyelohyoid space. Dear students, can you see the picture? So it is the space that exists between the myelohyoid ridge and the floor of the mouth. Its boundaries are very important and often asked during the exam. It is an anatomic area in the alveolo-lingual sulcus, which is just lingual to the retromolar pad, bounded interiorly by the retromyelohyoid ridge, posteriorly by the retromyelohyoid curtain, inferiorly by the floor of the alveolo-lingual sulcus, and lingually by the anterior tonsillar pillar when the tongue is in the relaxed position. So these are its boundaries. The next important point is that it is always measured at clinical rest position while the patient slightly retrudes the tongue with the help of the periodontal probe, scale or fingertip. Lateral throat form can be classified into three classes, class 1, 2 or 3. That is, on the basis of the space which is present between the myelohyoid ridge and the floor of the mouth. We can see this in the pictorial image on the right side. In class 1, approximately 0.5 inch space is present. So that is maximum and favorable for retention of the lower denture. In class 2, less than 0.5 inch space is present between the myelohyoid ridge and the floor of the mouth, which is less favorable as compared to the class 1. In class 3, the myelohyoid fold is at the same level of the myelohyoid ridge. Now, the retention becomes very challenging in these cases. Mucosa thickness. We all know that alveolar mucosa is the mucosal covering of the alveolar process. Question is, what is the ideal mucosa? Mucosa should be firmly attached to the underneath bone and resilient for good support to the dentures. House classified mucosa into three types. So, dear students, please listen carefully as questions are often asked from this topic. Let's come back to the classification. Class 1, that is the normal mucosa thickness, that is uniform density of mucosa of approximately 1 millimeter thickness is present. The investing membrane is firm and not tensed. It forms the ideal cushion for basal seat of the denture. Examiner asks you the ideal thickness. What is that? Yes, 1 millimeter. Which is the ideal mucosa? Yes, class 1. Next question is, how you check the thickness? By compressibility test, using the ball burnisher or the round end of the T burnisher. Now, class 2. Which can be further of two types, thin and thick mucosa. Thin mucosa has soft tissue with thin investing membrane, which is highly susceptible to irritation. You know, dear students, this type of mucosa is found on bony exostoses and torus. Now, this is again asked by the examiners. Then comes the thick mucosa. It has the soft tissue with twice the normal thickness. Good thing is that the investing membrane is still firm. So, no need for surgery. But yes, the dentures have the tendency to slide or shift on this type of mucosa. Class 3 type of mucosa. It has the soft tissue with thick investing membranes filled with redundant tissues. In this type, the surgical correction is must. If not corrected surgically, the dentures, they try to move excessively and they also cause soreness. So again, I repeat, the mucosa thickness is examined with ball burnisher or T burnisher by compressing gently by the compressibility test. One more point, when there are areas of both thick and thin mucosa in the same arch, it becomes impossible to equalize the pressure under denture and avoid soreness. With the thickness, mucosa condition is also noted. Mucosa condition is healthy, irritated, or pathologic. First, note the features of healthy mucosa. Coral pink color, free of any signs of inflammation, firmly attached and keratinized for providing good support to complete denture. Irritated mucosa shows the sign of inflammation. This can be due to the ill-fitting denture, smoking, infection, or systemic disease or any drug therapy. Pathologic mucosa may be seen with some lesions, white or red patches. Most common lesions I have mentioned on the slide. Lesions related to ulcers or inflammation should be treated first, followed by the denture fabrication. Lesions with flabby or hypermobile ridges offer poor support because the denture bases shift during function. These should be surgically or prosthetically managed. In the picture, you can see the flabby ridge. Window impression technique is used for flabby ridge cases. Frenal attachments. Frenum is a connecting fold of membrane that serves to support or retain a part. It influences the seal of a complete denture. It can be classified as class 1, 2, and 3. Class 1 is the frenal attachment which is closer to the vestibule, that is high in the maxilla or low in the mandibular sulcus. It has the most favorable prognosis. Class 2 frenum attachment is just midway between the sulcus and the crest of the ridge. Relieving of the frenum is done as long U-shaped notch is made for the maxillary labial frenum and broad V-shaped notch for the buccal frenum. Why? Because there is no muscle present in the maxillary labial frenum, and we know that three muscles are present in the buccal frenum which tend to move it in three directions. In class 3, the freni encroach the ridge crest. This makes the denture seal very challenging. We have two options. Either we make a large notch to allow the space for them or go for surgical correction. Long U-shaped notches in the maxillary labial frenum makes the labial flange weaker, and these dentures are prone to fracture in the midline area. This is one of the MCQs which is asked. Tongue. It is a highly mobile muscular organ and plays a significant role in complete denture fabrication and stability. When there is a loss of teeth and patient becomes edentulous, the tongue can become enlarged and powerful. Tongue size. As I told you, it becomes enlarged after the patient becomes edentulous in the absence of the teeth, which is normal to an extent. Okay, then the tongue size may be normal, macroglossia, that is the large tongue as we can see in the first picture, microglossia, small tongue as we can see in the second picture. In case of macroglossia, the lingual flange at the wax up stage should be designed in such a way that it increases the stability of the mandibular denture. We know that we need adequate room for the tongue to perform its functions. So what we can do? We can make the lingual flange flat or slightly concave to make the room for the tongue. Then we can use narrow posterior teeth for patients with macroglossia. Now, for microglossia, what we can do? We can make thick lingual flanges with wider posterior teeth so that the tongue can perform its functions properly. House classify tongue size as class 1, 2 and 3. Class 1 is the adequate size. How we examine the tongue size? Very important. Examiner asks you the method. How you will examine. So if the tongue fills the floor of the mouth at clinical rest position, but the alveolar ridges are exposed, so that means we have ideal or adequate size. We have the space to place the denture. Now, in class 2, the tongue slightly overfills the floor of the mouth. And in class 3, the tongue completely fills and the alveolar ridges are not visible. So that means the space for placing the denture is less or compromised. Problems with the class 3 tongue size. This is one of the frequent questions asked by the examiner. First is making impression becomes difficult. Then the denture stability is difficult to attain as lateral forces are being applied by the tongue. As I told you, in this, to increase the denture stability, we can modify the lingual flanges. We can make them flat or slightly concave so that the stability is maintained. Then after insertion, patient often complains of tongue biting. Patient needs to be counseled and treated symptomatically if the signs of trauma are present. Then gothic tracing becomes challenging, so it is not advisable in these cases. The postgraduate students should notice the tongue size before selecting the exam case. Then the enlarged tongue may be crowded or tongue cramping may be present. So that should be noted because it will interfere with the speech and also dislodge the denture again and again. On the other hand, a small tongue, it jeopardizes the lingual seal. So what we can do? We can make the lingual flanges thicker in case of a small tongue, or we can use wider posterior teeth. Why tongue is so important for complete denture fabrication? It is because the tongue position, tongue movement and muscular coordination are essential for border molding, impression and then ultimately the stability of the dentures. During all the physiologic activity as the speech, mastication and deglutition. Another very important factor is tongue position, important for keeping the dentures in place. Often framed as multiple choice question and also asked by the examiner. So according to Wright, tongue position can be normal, class 1 retracted and class 2 retracted. Let us understand the normal tongue position. We have to keep 3 points in our mind. First is the floor of the mouth, second the lateral border of the tongue and third is the apex of the tongue. If the tongue fills, the floor of the mouth, confined by the mandibular teeth or the lower alveolar ridge. The lateral border of the tongue rests on the occlusal surface of the posterior teeth, and the apex rests on the incisal edge of the lower anterior teeth. That means it is the normal tongue position. As you can see in the picture, in edentulous, the tip of the tongue rests on the lingual slope of the lower anterior alveolar ridge. Class 1 retracted tongue position. Again, 3 points: the floor of the mouth, the lateral border of the tongue, and apex of the tongue. So in class 1 retracted position, the floor of the mouth is pulled downward and exposed back to the molar area. The lateral borders of the tongue are raised above the occlusal plane, and the apex of the tongue, very important, is pulled downward into the floor of the mouth. So this is class 1 retracted tongue position. We can see all the 3 things in the picture. Class 2 retracted tongue position. This position most frequently breaks the lingual seal. In this, the tongue is tensed, pulled backward and upward, dislodging the denture. So let's understand the 3 points. First, the floor of the mouth is raised and tensed. The lateral borders of the tongue, they rest above the mandibular occlusal plane. And most important, the apex of the tongue is pulled back into the body of the tongue, which almost disappears. We can see in the picture how the apex is pulled back and it breaks the seal of the denture. This is a clinical picture showing the retracted tongue position and high lingual frenum. This breaks the lingual seal of the lower denture repeatedly. We can make training grooves on the lingual side of the anterior lingual flange so that we can ask the patient to keep the tongue on those grooves. Saliva. We already know saliva is a slightly alkaline secretion of water, mucin, protein, salts, and often a starch splitting enzyme as tylene. It is secreted by the salivary glands. Its main function is lubrication. It lubricates the ingested food and begins the breakdown of starches. Saliva has a very important role in denture retention. The adhesive action of the thin film of saliva present between the denture base and the underlying soft tissues is one of the principal factors that aids in denture retention. This adhesive action is due to the ionic forces between the charged salivary glycoproteins and surface epithelium on one side and the denture base acrylic on the other side. Besides, the cohesive forces between the layers of saliva and interfacial surface tension also plays a very important role in denture retention. So what we conclude that the amount and the consistency both of saliva is very, very important for denture fabrication process and its success. Amount or quantity of saliva, which can be normal, excessive or inadequate. The normal daily production of saliva is around 0.5 to 1.5 liter. It can be asked by the examiner. As we discussed that it plays an important role in denture retention. So the retention of the denture becomes challenging in dry mouth and increased potential for soreness can be seen. Dear students, the normal flow rate of saliva is also important, which is around 0.5 to 1 ml per minute. Answer to this question can give you a bonus mark, and also it is a question in multiple choice questions. Type or quality of saliva: seromucus, serous, and mucus. Serous, that is thin film of saliva, which is good or will say the best for retention. And this is the most commonly found. A thick, ropey mucous saliva may compromise with the maxillary denture retention by creating a negative hydrostatic pressure in the area of the posterior palatal seal, just interior to the posterior palatal seal, leading to a downward dislodgement of the denture. Saliva classification. This is the formal classification. Class 1, normal amount and consistency. Class 2, excessive. That can be thin, watery or thick, ropey. Excessive saliva may cause some problems like gagging. It may complicate the impression making. So what we can do? We can irrigate the mouth with astringent mouthwash before making the impression. As we discussed earlier, it also affects the denture retention, especially the thick, ropey saliva. It tends to accumulate between the tissue and the denture. Thus, it affects the seal of the denture. Class 3 is inadequate. As we talked about it, that it reduces the retentive qualities of the denture and also cause soreness. How to examine saliva in the mouth? We will say class 1, it is normal if it just wet the floor of the mouth. We will say class 2, it is excessive if the floor is pooled with saliva and drooling may be present. With the cotton swab, you can check the consistency also. If the cotton swab makes threads of the saliva being pulled, means it is sticky, ropey and thick. It is class 3 if there is dry floor of the mouth. The threads of the cotton swab sticks to the mucosa in the absence of saliva. So, one more thing. Silicones are the preferred impression materials for class 3 cases. We will not use impression paste. Three definitions, favorite of all the examiner: prognosis, diagnosis and treatment planning. So what is a prognosis? It can be defined as a forecast as to the probable result of a disease or a course of therapy. We often write the prognosis as poor, fair or good. Okay, so it is the examiner's favorite definition to ask during the chairside viva. Second is diagnosis. Diagnosis is defined as the determination of nature of disease. Like the diagnosis we make, upper and lower completely edentulous arches. Okay, third is treatment planning. Treatment planning is defined as the sequence of the procedure planned for the treatment of the patient after diagnosis. That is, if you are planning to make upper and lower complete dentures with heat cure acrylic resin. So that is a brief treatment planning you should write. Examination of the existing dentures. Very important for clinical judgment and again one of the favorite question of the examiner, especially if your patient is already a denture wearer. So the following points should be considered. First is interior and posterior teeth selection. Shade, size, form and material of the teeth should be observed and noted. Aesthetics, phonetics, retention, stability, extension and contours of the flanges should be carefully noted. It will give you the idea of what the patient is already adaptable. Then centric relation and the vertical dimension at occlusion. It should be rated as acceptable or unacceptable. If unacceptable, it should be observed that whether there is inadequate or excessive video. Then occlusal plane orientation, it should be noted if reverse smile is present, if posterior teeth slope downward or if it does not follow the arc of lower lip. These points should be carefully noted. Palate, thickness of the palate should be evaluated. Presence or absence of rugae on the polishing surface should also be noted. Then the placement of rugae or change in the thickness of the palate, it affects the phonetics of the patient. Post-dam, the posterior seal should be checked clinically. It should be rated as acceptable or unacceptable. Denture-based adaptation. Adaptation of the existing denture is very, very important and it should be checked with a disclosing medium. It should again be rated as acceptable or unacceptable. Midline. It should be noted that if the midline coincides or not with the facial midline. Amount of deviation, if it is present, should be noted and the direction towards which it is deviated should also be noted. Crossbite. Crossbite should be evaluated if it is unilateral or bilateral or not present. Characterization should be evaluated so that we can rehabilitate in the similar manner. Comfort. Patient is comfortable or not. Then the reason or the source of the discomfort should also be checked. Hygiene. It should be evaluated as good, fair or poor by seeing the condition of the denture. Then patient should be counseled accordingly. Wear. This is the indication of parafunctional habits or abrasive diet. So wear factor should be observed carefully and it should be assessed with respect to time. It can be classified as minimal, moderate or severe. Use of chemical or mechanical retainer. Use of any suction tips in maxillary denture or patient using any kind of denture adhesive should also be checked. So these kind of patient, they need special counseling session. Radiographs. You often get a short note on the importance of radiographs in completely edentulous patient. Radiographs are an essential part of diagnosis and treatment planning of complete denture patients. Panoramic radiographs are the most commonly advised as they capture the entire maxilla and mandible. So this becomes the best option as small amount of radiation provides valuable information. Now coming to the importance of radiographs. First is screening the jaw defects, bony enlargement or any kind of displacement. Unerupted teeth, root retained fragments, foreign bodies, radiolucencies, radioopacities or any kind of defined or ill-defined lesions must be looked. Maxillary sinus must be checked for any inflammation, cyst, polyps or tumors. And last but very important is amount of resorption can be calculated from panoramic radiograph. How? There is a formula. Original alveolar ridge crest height is equal to the distance between the inferior border of the mandible to the inferior margin of the mental foramen multiplied by 3. So this is how we can obtain the original alveolar ridge height from the panoramic radiograph. So that's all for today, dear students. Thank you all. Please like and share the video and subscribe for more and more learning. You can mention your topics in the comment section or you can just send a mail to drshwetaprastho@gmail.com. Take care of yourself. Wish you success.